Well, happy Sabbath, everyone, and welcome to this evening's study. This is, I think it's study number 86 in the study on the three angels' messages of righteousness by faith. And I know it's a lot of information that we have gone through, a lot of reading, but a little bit of discussion here and there. But I think it's definitely helpful to read it through in this way, that if you just read this on your own, you wouldn't pick up as much stuff. But I wouldn't even pick up as much stuff, even though I've gone through this quite a bit in the past. But we're going to probably get into my favorite section of this book today, because we're getting close to it, because it's around page 60-something. But before we begin, can you join me in a word of prayer? Dear gracious Heavenly Father, we are so thankful for the Sabbath and for each person who is searching for truth, wanting to know you, and we invite your presence into our midst. Even though we're not together physically, we know, Lord, that you can unite our hearts and our minds, and that you can give us wisdom and understanding. We know, Lord, we live in a world of sin, and that we are sinners, and we need your grace and mercy and your power in our lives. We want to be like Christ, and we know, Lord, that we are far from that, that goal, but we know that you can live in us. And so we ask that the things that we learn as we study together can bring us closer to you. We pray for one another. We know, Lord, that this Sabbath is always a blessing. And there's many, many of us have difficulties and trials and worries that try to bleed over from the week. We just ask, Lord, that we can set those aside and that we can know your love and your comfort. We pray for our family and friends who are struggling in various ways, and some that don't know you, and others that may have known you, and some that are struggling in their faith. We just pray, Lord, that we can be an encouragement to them. Be with us now. We pray and ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, happy Sabbath again. And I really enjoy this book by Wagner. Now, I'm actually not a fan of E.J. Wagner's writing style. I prefer A.T. Jones. It's just there's a difference in how they present. But this book I appreciate, and especially, I mean, obviously I appreciate his ideas, but the way that he's going to address the nature of Christ that's going to be coming up, dealing with the law in Galatians. And so, but first, before we get to that part of this book, which starts around page 60 or so, we have this interesting exchange. And when I was reading through this earlier, and I want you to think about this, and we've talked about it quite a bit. One of the things that amazes me, and I was talking with Iran about it earlier, Iran, is that, well, I used to think that the reason why people disagreed is they weren't fully informed. That is, if we knew enough, we would all come to the same conclusions, that if we were presented with the same information, we would draw the same conclusions. And it wasn't until I was about 25 that I realized that people actually think differently. And a lot of it has to do with not so much an intellectual problem, but more an emotional problem. That is, we become emotionally invested in our perspective of the world, that there's a type of insecurity that exists. That if somebody comes along and sort of shows us that we're wrong about something, for many people that's very, very difficult. And I see this problem here with Butler and Wagner. That is, you know, when we've all experienced it, where we've we talk past somebody that we're talking to, not really listening. But we've seen other people do it. And so I'm always amazed at this, that this discussion that we see here that was so much a part of Adventist history, 1888, and really that the problem wasn't so much one of the mind as of the heart. And, if we are truly converted, we can learn to listen and to understand people who are different. And I believe that the Jones and Wagner definitely lean more towards the ability to sort of listen to what people are saying than Butler has. Butler doesn't appear to have that ability. And I know it's not always fair, but sometimes I tend to judge people for their opinions or, their views based on how emotional they are. I don't know if that's always really fair. But when somebody's really emotionally invested in an idea, I tend to put less trust in their conclusions. So, if somebody's a little bit more detached from an idea emotionally, I tend to take more weight in their opinions and their views. But and we've seen this, of course, in action, where people, often get quite upset when somebody has a different view than them, which seems to be an odd thing. And I should have figured this out a lot sooner because my dad was really emotionally invested in his views. I didn't really understand them until I had children, why my dad was the way he was, and part of it was just the insecurity of having his children believe differently than him. It was really threatening to him. So, but at the time, I didn't really understand why. Anyway, we're going to read some stuff here. So that's sort of an whole aside, but it's just an interesting, observation about what we see here. And we see this here in how, so he's going to quote Butler. And how Butler frames this argument, and is using a straw man, that is, he hasn't really listened to what Wagner has said. He's assuming that if Wagner takes one position, he must be having this whole other view. So anyway, he says, so this is in page 56 of Butler's book, and it happens to be page 56 of this book as well. What are these elements which the apostle speaks of in which you were in bondage until God sent forth his son made under the law? Are they the commandments of God, the law of liberty, that holy, pure law which will be the rule of in the judgment? We think this would be a conclusion most absurd. We claim with great confidence that these elements refer to a different system. The original word is defined by Greenfield. Elementary instruction, first principles, the lowest rudiments in knowledge, science, etc. The word is translated rudiments in the Revised Version and in the Diaglot, that's interlinear. The same word occurs in Colossians 2:20, where it is translated rudiments. So Wagner responds to what Butler has said here. He says, "I've never been guilty of the absurdity of claiming that these elements are the commandments of God." Now, the question is, why would Butler even propose that? So Butler has this false dichotomy. It's either that these elements are the Ten Commandments or they're the ceremonial law. And of course, Wagner's never taken the position that the elements of the world refer to the commandments of God, right? So he says, "I'm just as confident as you are that they refer to something else. Paul tells me what they are. And when he says that they are the elements of the world, you say this means the ceremonial law. Will you please tell me what the world had to do with the ceremonial law? If the ceremonial law was the elements of the world, then the world ought to have adopted it instead of despising the Jews because of it. And we know that the world will love its own. And will you tell me how you reconcile the statement that the ceremonial law is the elements of the world with your previous statement that it was given by angels? It does not change the argument a particle to translate the word rudiments. I readily grant that rudiments of the world in Colossians 2:20 mean the same as the elements of the world in Galatians 4:3. I also claim, what I think you will hardly deny, that the term rudiments in Colossians 2, verse 8, has the same meaning that it has in the 20th verse. It is precisely the same term. Now, in testimony number 7, in the chapter on philosophy and vain deceit, Sister White quotes Colossians 2, verse 8, and says that she was shown that this verse has a special reference to spiritualism. That is, philosophy and vain deceit or spiritualism is after the rudiments of the world. Will you claim that there is any connection whatever between the ceremonial law and spiritualism? Is spiritualism according to the ceremonial law which God gave to the Jews? Impossible. But it is according to the elements of the world, to the carnal mind, which is enmity against God. It is according to the course of this world, according to the rudiments or elements of the world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience, among whom also we all had our conversation or manner of life in times past, in the lusts of the flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, when we were by nature the children of wrath, Ephesians 2, verse 2 and 3. The elements of the world are the things that are in the world, namely the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eyes and the pride of life, 1 John 2, verse 15 and 16. These are not of the Father, but are of the world. They are practiced by those who know not God, and to these things we were all subject before we were quickened, made alive by grace. It is not, as you say on page 57, that their being under these elements or rudiments brought them into bondage, but their being under these elements was in itself the bondage of corruption or sin. On page 58 is a paragraph which contains some points that I wish especially to notice, and so I quote it entire. It is the following. And this is going to be, this is the part here. So I guess it actually starts on page 57 or 8 here, that I've often quoted in sermons. So this part. So first we're going to have Butler's statement. In verse 4, where Paul speaks of God sending forth his son, made of a woman, we have the expression made under the law. We have already considered the meaning of this term under the law and have already shown that it does not always mean under the condemnation of the law, but rather under the authority of the law or under obligation to keep it. The term evidently has this meaning here. Both the Revised Version and the Diaglots translate made under the law, born under the law. So they're going to translate it as born under the law. Greenfield, in the definition of the original word, which has a great variety of significations, quotes its use in this fourth verse with the definition subject to the law. This evidently is the correct sense in which it should be used. It is not true that our Savior was born under the condemnation of the law. So I want you to pay attention to this. This to me, when I read this and also A.T. Jones' book, The Consecrated Way to Christian Perfection. This to me was really the key to understanding righteousness by faith and what the issue was in 1888. And it is this issue here. So Butler says it is not true that our Savior was born under the condemnation of the law. This would be manifestly absurd, that he did voluntarily take the sins of the world upon him in his great sacrifice upon the cross, we admit. But he was not born under its condemnation. Of him that was pure and had never committed a sin in his life, It would be an astonishing perversion of all proper theology to say he was born under the condemnation of the law. So this is extremely important. So I'm double underlining it, putting it in yellow highlights, right, for you to think about. Now Wagner is going to respond to this. And we have to think about, do we actually agree with what Wagner says? Is it something that we've already understood? And if we hadn't already understood this, would it be something that we recognize that it must be so? So he's going to address this. He says, concerning the term under the law, you say that you have shown that it does not always mean under the condemnation of the law, but rather under the authority of the law or under obligation to keep the law. And I've carefully reread all previous references to it. And while I find several assertions to that effect, I find not one item of proof. To be sure, you quote from Greenfield, but I don't consider his assertion as of any more value than that of any other man. I cannot take the space here to quote all the occurrences of the term under the law and show its meaning, but I wish to make this point. In Romans 6:14 and 15 and Galatians 5:18, the expression occurs, and there cannot be the slightest doubt, but that it means condemned by the law. You would not dare give it the meaning subject to the law in those places. There can be no controversy concerning its use in those texts. Now, it is a fixed principle in biblical interpretation that the controverted texts must be settled by appeal to texts which are uncontroverted. Moreover, consistency requires that any term should have the same meaning wherever it occurs in the Bible, unless context shows beyond question that it must have a different meaning. Now, there is no place in the Bible where it does not make good sense to interpret under the law as condemned by the law. But in the texts which I have just referred to, it cannot possibly mean subject to the law. If the limits of this review would warrant it, I would show by positive evidence from Scripture, not by quotations from commentaries, that under the law invariably means condemned by the law. Oh, and that it cannot by any possibility mean anything else. Of course, I accept the two places, 1 Corinthians 9:21 and Romans 3:19, where it is not found in the original. Okay, so I mean, he's said this before in other places in his response, but here he puts it really clearly that when it talks about under the law, we need to understand it is condemned by the law. And then he's going to address Greenfield and commentators. I must protest once more against your dependence upon the opinion of commentators. You say Greenfield in the definition of the original word, which has a great variety of significations, quotes its use in this fourth verse with the definition subject to the law. This is evidently the correct sense in which it should be used. Why is it evidently the sense in which it should be used? Because Greenfield says so? Must we accept every one of Greenfield's opinions as of final authority in matters of faith? I'm not prepared to do this. Do not misunderstand me. I'm not casting any reflections upon Greenfield as a lexicographer, but as a commentator. When Greenfield gives a simple definition of a word, it is to be accepted, provided it agrees with the definition given in the classical lexicons. For words are not used in Scripture in a special scriptural sense, but in their ordinary acceptation. But when Greenfield, or any other man, says that a word which has several different shades of meaning is used in a certain sense in any specific text, he is simply giving his opinion, not of the meaning of the word, but of the meaning of the text. And when he does that, anybody may challenge his opinion and demand the proof. If we are to quote the opinions of men as authority on points of doctrine, we might as well turn papists at once. For to pin one's faith to the opinions of man is of the very essence of the papacy. It matters not whether we adhere to the opinions of one man or to the opinions of 40, whether we have one pope or 40, because a man has written a commentary on the Bible or on any part of it, that is no reason why his opinion should pass unchallenged. He is only a man still. Seventh-day Adventists, of all people in the world, ought to be free from dependence upon the mere opinion of men. They should be Protestants, indeed, testing everything by the Bible alone. And of course, we know that as we've been going through our morning studies and all of our different studies, we're challenging even ourselves based upon God's word. Even our own opinions need to be tested by God's word. Sometimes we change our opinions based upon the evidence. Okay, so the next part, this is really, really good. So now, as to the rendering of the expression under the law in Galatians 4, verse 4, I have no fault to find with the rendering born under the law, but I think that it is the correct rendering. I will go farther than you do and will offer some scripture evidence on this point. John 1, verse 1 and verse 14 says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. The word made, rendered made, is the same as that in Galatians 4, 4, and evidently signifies born, right? So he was made flesh, he was born flesh. The word was God, yet was born flesh of the Virgin Mary. I don't know how it could be so. I simply accept the Bible statement. Now read in Romans 8, 3, and you will learn the nature of the flesh, which the word was made. For what the law could not do, in that it was weak through the flesh, God sending his own son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and for sin, or because of sin, condemned sin in the flesh. Christ was born in the likeness of sinful flesh. Philippians 2, verse 5 to 7. Have this mind in you, or let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, counted it not a prize to be on equality with God, but emptied himself, taking the form of a servant, being made in the likeness of men. So this is the revised version. Now note the next verse. And being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself, becoming obedient even unto death, yea, the death of the cross. And now compare the above with Hebrews 2, verse 9. But we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor, that he, by the grace of God, should taste death for every man. These texts show that Christ took upon himself man's nature, and that, as a consequence, he was subject to death. Right? Now, this is a really important point. Now, if Christ had not taken upon man's nature in its fallen condition, could he have died on the cross? Right. He had to take a nature that was subject to death, right? And I know one of the problems that that has crept into this discussion regarding righteousness by faith and the nature of Christ and so forth is back in the 80s and 90s. We had a lot of conservative Adventist theologians taking the position that even though they were professing to teach Jones and Wagner's understanding of things, they were taking the idea that Jesus did not take upon, they said he took man's nature, but not its, well, they would talk about what they called original sin. And that's because there was a false argument that was put in. The idea was that the reason that we sin, this is a Catholic idea, is that we have a sinful nature, right? Because of total depravity, original sin. And so we're not sinners because we choose to sin. We're sinners because we're born sinners, that we're guilty. And so Christ couldn't have taken upon himself a nature that was depraved, sinful, because then he would have been a sinner. But the question is, Was Christ made a sinner by taking upon himself our nature and yet did not himself sin? This is what Jones and Wagner are teaching. That Christ, in order to redeem sinners, he had to take upon sinful nature. And sinful nature is condemned. Christ took a condemned nature. But just because he took a condemned nature doesn't mean that he had to sin, because he had the flesh and the body of sin, but he had the mind of God. Christ was born again. And so when we become born again, we can be partakers of the divine nature and escape the corruption that is in the world through lust. Right? So to be born again doesn't change our physical nature. We still have a sinful nature. Jesus had a sinful nature. But we get a new nature, a new mind. And that mind, and we did this when we went through Jones' 1895 General Conference Bulletin, because he goes through this. But Wagner's now dealing with the crux of the issue here over the long Galatians. It has to do with the nature of Christ. It wasn't some, sort of academic discussion regarding, how we should translate this verse so that when we're debating people, we can win the argument when they say that the law is done away, right? But that it's actually central to the gospel to understand this truth, and that this had been obscured within Adventism, understanding the nature of Christ correctly. So, so he quotes all these different verses, and then he says, these texts show that Christ took upon himself man's nature, and that as a consequence, he was subject to death, right? He came into the world on purpose to die. And so from the beginning of his earthly life, he was in the same condition that men are in whom he died to save. Now read Romans 1 verse 3, the gospel of God concerning his son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, which was made of the seed of David according to the flesh. Now, what was the nature of David according to the flesh? Sinful, was it not? David says, behold, I was shapen in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive me, Psalms 51, verse 5. Don't start in horrified astonishment. I'm not implying that Christ was a sinner. I shall explain more fully in a few moments. But first, I wish to quote Hebrews 2, verse 16 and 17. For verily he took not on him the nature of angels, but he took on him the seed of Abraham. Wherefore, in all things, it behooved him to be made like unto his brethren, that he might be a merciful and faithful high priest in things pertaining to God, to make reconciliation for the sins of the people. His being made in all things like unto his brethren is the same as his being made in the likeness of sinful flesh, made in the likeness of men. One of the most encouraging things in the Bible is the knowledge that Christ took on him the nature of man, to know that his ancestors, according to the flesh, were sinners. When we read the record of the lives of the ancestors of Christ and see that they had all the weaknesses and passions that we have, we find that no man has any right to excuse his sinful acts on the ground of heredity. If Christ had not been made in all things like unto his brethren, then his sinless life would be no encouragement to us. We might look at it with admiration, but it would be the admiration that would cause hopeless despair. And now, as another parallel to Galatians 4:4 and a further source of encouragement to us, I will quote 2 Corinthians 5:21. For he hath made him to be sin for us, who knew no sin, that is, Christ knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. Now, when was Jesus made sin for us? It must have been when he was made flesh and began to suffer the temptations and infirmities that are incident to sinful flesh. He passed through every phase of human experience, being in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. He was a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. He hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, Isaiah 53, verse 4. And this scripture is said by Matthew to have been fulfilled long before the crucifixion. So I say that he was being born, that his being born under the law was a necessary consequence of his being born in the likeness of sinful flesh, of taking upon himself the nature of Abraham. He was made like man in order that he might undergo the suffering of death from the earliest childhood. The cross was ever before him. Now, A.T. Jones addresses this in A Consecrated Way to Christian Perfection. He addresses this verse, you know, directly, Galatians 4:4. And I'm just going to read that. Okay, so in this book, The Consecrated Way to Christian Perfection, and I'll bring it up here so you can see it. And I'm not sure which chapter, because Jones goes through this in a lot more detail than Wagner does. He's going to talk in here. He's a chapter made under law, and I believe it's this one, made of a woman, right? So that's going to address Galatians 4:4. So Jones says, by what means was Christ made flesh? Through what means was he a partaker of human nature? Exactly the same means as are all of us partakers, all of the children of men. For it is written, as the children of the man are partakers of flesh and blood, he also himself likewise took part of the same. Likewise signifies in the like way, thus in the same way. So he partook of the same flesh and blood that men have in the same way that men partake of it. Men partake of it by birth. So likewise did he. Accordingly, it is written, unto us a child is born. So this is actually a really good argument for saying that Christ was born of a woman, born under the law, rather than saying, you know, made of a woman, made under the law, right? So that, so it's really clear here. And then he's going to quote, of course, Galatians 4:4, God sent forth a son made of a woman. He being made of a woman in this world, in the nature of things, he was made of the only kind of woman that this world knows. But why must he be made of a woman and not a man? For the simple reason that to be made of a man would not bring him close enough to mankind, as mankind is under sin. He was made of a woman in order that he might come in the very uttermost to where human nature is in its sinning. In order to do this, he must be made of a woman, because the woman, not the man, was first and originally in the transgression. For Adam was not deceived, but the woman, being deceived, was in the transgression. I've been made only of the descent of man. To have been made only of the descent of man would have been to come short of the full breadth of the field of sin, because the woman had sinned, and sin was thus in the world before the man sinned. Christ was thus made of a woman in order that he might meet the great world of sin at its very fountainhead of entrance into this world. To have been made otherwise than of a woman would have been to come short of this, and so would have been only to miss completely the redemption of man from sin. It was the seed of the woman that was to bruise the serpent's head, and it was only as the seed of the woman and made of a woman that he could meet the serpent on his own ground at the very point of the entrance of sin into this world. It was the woman who in this world was originally in the transgression. It was the woman by whom sin originally entered. Therefore, the redemption of the children of men from sin, he who would be the redeemer must go back of the man to meet the sin that was in the world before the man sinned. Right? So, and then I'm just going to skip some of this here. Okay, he says here, therefore, he was made under the law because they are under the law whom he would redeem. And as he was made a curse, because they are under the curse whom he would redeem. And as he was made sin, because they are sinners sold under sin, whom he would redeem, precisely so he must be made flesh, the same flesh and blood, because they are the flesh and blood whom he would redeem, and must be made of a woman, because sin was in the world first by and in the woman. Okay, so he definitely goes through that clearly. And I'm just seeing, yeah, this is a long chapter. And I'm going to read the end of the previous chapter where it says he was made under the law. And this is the one that I read this to Ron Spear when he was at Silver Hills. That was a self-supporting school I was at, and he came and visited when I was there as a student when I was 24. And I read this to him. I remember specifically where I was when I read it to him, and it was in the guest house in the library downstairs. Pulled this book out and read this to him, and he was very upset and called it heresy. So here's what Ron Spear called heresy, and many conservative Adventists at that time would have called this heresy, even though they professed to believe in Jones and Wagner. So starting at the top of page 30, he was made under the law to redeem them that are under the law. He was made a curse to redeem them that are under the curse because of being under the law. But whomsoever it was done, whomso, but for so, whomsoever it was done, and whatsoever is accomplished by the doing of it, there must never be forgotten the fact that in order to the doing of that which was done, he had to be made. That which those already were for whom the thing was done, right? So that makes sense. Any man, therefore, in all the world who knows guilt by that very thing also knows what Jesus felt for him, and by this knows how close Jesus has come to him. Whosoever knows what is condemnation in that knows exactly what Jesus felt for him, and so knows how thoroughly Jesus is able to sympathize with him and to redeem him. Whosoever knows the curse of sin, the plague of his own heart, in that can know exactly what Jesus experienced for him, and how entirely Jesus identified himself in very experience with him, bearing guilt, being under the condemnation, and so under the weight of the curse. Jesus, a whole lifetime in this world of guilt, condemnation, and the curse, live the perfect life of the righteousness of God without ever sinning at all. And whenever any man, knowing guilt, condemnation, and the curse of sin, and knowing that Jesus actually felt in his experience all this just as man feels it, then in addition, that man, by believing in Jesus, can know in his experience the blessedness of the perfect life of the righteousness of God in his life to redeem him from guilt, from condemnation, and from the curse, and to be manifested in his whole lifetime to keep him from ever sinning at all. Christ was made under the law to redeem them that were under the law, and that blessed work is accomplished for every soul who accepts of that redemption. So I don't know what people think of that. I mean, I know some of you have been following these studies, and we've talked about this many times. But is this something that people have, is this a new idea to anybody? Is this something that at one time would have been a new idea, like even as a Seventh-day Adventist? Any thoughts on this?
Oh, question.
Okay.
So if you were to sum that up in like an outline, what would be the main points in there that people thought were heresy?
Well, the idea that Jesus actually felt the sin, the condemnation, and the curse of sin his whole lifetime. So remember what Butler said. He says, well, here, I'll go back, read what he said. So when we go back here, he said, it is not true that our Savior was born under the condemnation of the law. This would be manifestly absurd, right? That he did voluntarily take the sins of the world upon him in his great sacrifice on the cross, we admit, but he was not born under its condemnation. Of him that was pure and had never committed a sin in his life, it would be an astonishing perversion of all proper theology to say he was born under the condemnation of the law. And you can see that that this is not well accepted. I mean, anytime I've presented this, and that's what I used to mostly just preach on the nature of Christ for years and years and years before I got into this message. That was basically what I preached on. And I would read this section from Wagner's book. I'd read also from A.T. Jones, and there's also a lot of spirit of prophecy statements as well. But people seem to just miss this whole point, right? And that's because they think that this smacks of original sin, that we are not born guilty. We're not born under the condemnation of the law, right? That's what many people think. They think, well, we actually have to sin before we are condemned. But we actually took a nature that is subject to death, right?
I'm not
That's
sure
a
on that
condemnation.
one. That's pretty close to the idea that all babies are saved.
The idea that we're not born under the condemnation of the law.
Yeah, like, are we born lost? So
See,
is that not the condemnation of the law?
yeah. So we're born lost. Without a savior, we're lost. Now, it's true that we're going to sin without a savior, but we're already taking a nature that's condemned. And this is not a popular view in Adventism. Now, Catholics teach that babies are naturally sinners, right? So you can see where this idea comes from, or where it's been twisted. And why it's been fought against, because they teach, that's why they teach you have to baptize babies, because they're sinners. And if you didn't baptize them, well, if they died, then they would be lost, right? So they need to be baptized. And so that's the reaction that people have to this, is they think this smacks of original sin. But original sin teaches that it is impossible to have a sinful nature and not commit sin. But Christ demonstrated that it's possible to have a sinful nature and not commit sin, right? In order for us to overcome sin, Christ had to come in our nature and overcome sin on our behalf. If he had just come in a
Okay,
sinless,
so it's the sinful nature in every human that is condemned under the law. We're born under that condemnation of, just in the sense of our nature is condemned. Is that, am I thinking right there? And that we only, well.
Our nature is condemned. We're okay. Well, here's another way that I've illustrated it, at least from my experience. So, when I was younger, before I had done any great sins, I was highly sensitive to the idea of sin. So much so that if I saw someone else committing sin, I would feel guilty as if I had done the sin myself. I don't know if other people had that experience. And what I believe that was the nature that we have, is that we feel guilt. Ellen White says that Christ, as a child, when he was criticized by his brothers, for doing good, and they, of course, condemned him for it, that he felt guilty as if he was actually doing wrong. And it's not word for word. This is just kind of a paraphrase. You can, if you read Uncle Arthur's Bible storybooks, he paints Christ as like having this happy-go-lucky childhood. He was just this really, really good kid, and everything was wonderful. But actually, Ellen White shows that Christ's life as a child, that he had a cross to bear, and one of that was the feelings of condemnation, right? When criticized. So what he's talking about here, what Wagner and Jones are talking about, is the feelings that Christ had in taking upon himself man's nature in its fallen condition. He felt condemned. He felt guilt. He felt the curse. right? He felt all of those things that sinners feel, but without actually committing sin himself. He didn't have to commit sin in order to feel the weight of the sins of the world upon him. Now, at the cross, the difference between the cross and before was not Christ's nature. He didn't suddenly have feel guilt and condemnation and the curse. What happened is his Father's presence was withdrawn, and now he had to tread the wine press alone. Before, he could cling to his Father. In spite of what he felt, he could trust in his Father's love, right? He could know that he's accepted by his Father. But as his life progresses, mm-hmm. and as he comes closer to the cross, and his Father's presence is withdrawn, Christ now is experiencing what it feels like to be not just guilty or condemned, but to be treated as God would treat the sinner when he brings his final judgment upon him. Christ now is experiencing yeah. the wrath of God, right? He didn't experience the wrath before.
Christ experienced. Christ felt like, you know, he died the death of the wicked, and it was only by faith that he had faith in his Father. He couldn't feel it, but he couldn't see it, but he knew it by faith, that knowing his Father, he put himself in his Father's hands and your will be done, trusting that whatever that will was, it would be ultimately good. And he couldn't see on the other side of the tomb. That's the amazing thing. It wasn't like, okay, well, I feel like a sinner and I'm condemned and I'll just die and don't worry about it. I'll be alive again in a few days. He didn't even think that. He was dying forever in his mind. Is that not
right.
correct?
Yeah. Yeah. He felt that that sin was so hateful towards God that he did not see the hope of him coming up in the resurrection. Yet he still continued mm-hmm. to drink because of his love for us. So now Wagner's going to address this point that we just had read. You say that he did voluntarily take the sins of the world upon him in his great sacrifice upon the cross, we admit. Right? So this is what Mother had said. But he was not born under its condemnation of him that was pure, never committed to sin in his life. It would be an astonishing perversion of all proper theology to say that he was born under the condemnation of the law. So Wagner says, it may be a perversion of theology, but it is exactly in harmony with the Bible. And that is the main point. Can you not see that your objection lies as much against your position as it does mine? You are shocked at the idea that Jesus was born under the condemnation of the law because he never committed a sin in his life. But you admit that on the cross he was under the condemnation of the law. What? Had he then committed sin? Not by any means. Well then, if Jesus could be under the condemnation of the law at one time in his life and be sinless, I see no reason why he could not be under the condemnation of the law at another time and still be sinless. And Paul declares that God did make him to be sin for us. I simply give scripture facts. I don't attempt to explain them. Without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. I cannot understand how God could be manifest in the flesh and in the likeness of sinful flesh. I do not know how the pure and holy Savior could endure all the infirmities of humanity, which are the result of sin, and be reckoned as a sinner and suffer the death of a sinner. I simply accept the scripture statement that only so could he be the Savior of men. And I rejoice in that knowledge because since he was made sin, I may be made the righteousness of God in him. What a wonder. Christ had all the glory of heaven. We had nothing. And so he emptied himself, became nothing, in order that we might be glorified together with him and inherit all things. Christ was sinless, the very embodiment of holiness. We were vile and full of sin, having no good thing in us. He was made sin in order that we might be partakers of his righteousness. Christ was immortal, having life in himself. We were mortal, doomed to eternal death. He suffered death for us in order that we might share his immortality. He went to the very lowest depths to which man had fallen, in order that he might lift man to his own exalted throne, that he never ceased to be God or lost a particle of his holiness. Again, why was Jesus baptized? He said that it was to fulfill all righteousness. And we may not say that it was simply as an example, for that would be really denying the vicarious nature of the atonement. It must have been for the same reason that he died, namely for sin, not his own sin, but ours. For as in his death, so in his life, even from his birth, under the condemnation of the law, it was not his own account, but ours. I think that I've shown clearly by abundance of scripture testimony that Christ was born under the condemnation of the law, and that this was necessarily incident to the fact that he was born of a woman. For man that is born of a woman is a few days and full of trouble. And this was literally true of Christ. He was in all things like his brethren, in his life of temptation and suffering, and even to length of days, for his earthly life was exactly the length of an average human life. I must make one more argument, taking your standpoint. And let me see. Well, I'm going to read this one. I must take one more argument, taking your standpoint, that I will allow for the moment what is not true, that under the law means subject to the law, and that the law referred to is the ceremonial law. Now, the statement is that Christ was made under the law to redeem them that were under the law. He redeems none who were not in the condition which he was made. And since only the Jews were subject to the ceremonial law, your theory would make it that he came to save only the Jews. I'm glad that a proper interpretation does not oblige us to limit the plan of salvation in this way. Christ died for all men. All men are under the condemnation of the law of God. And so he was made under its condemnation. By the grace of God, he tasted death for every man. So we're going to stop there, but we're just going to address a couple of things here. So I'm hoping that, you know, people watching this and people here can see that the issue of the law in Galatians really was an issue about the nature of Christ. Now, remember, this is before 1888 that this discussion is going on, right? This is 1887 that he writes this. So now when they get to 1888 and after, G.I. Butler is not convinced by what Wagner has written here, right? The law in Galatians becomes this really hot button topic at the 1888 General Conference. And that amazes me, because Wagner's explanation is very, very powerful. I mean, it is the gospel, right? What he's presenting here is, this is not some academic exercises. They're not arguing over, you know, some minor point. This is the gospel that they're arguing over. And G.I. Butler has no idea what the gospel is. Is not that amazing? You would think any Seventh Adventist reading this would just accept this. They would just see the logic of it. Yeah, Jeff?
Kind of shocking.
Well, shocking.
Yeah, now, of course.
And I think if we ask the average pastor in our pulpits today, that they would also not understand it this way. I don't know.
No. I don't think, I mean, it's rare for me to find someone who understood this. I mean, and I've shared it with lots of people. Like, normally I would go, like, I mean, obviously in Warburg, I shared it all the time, but often I would speak in other churches, I remember presenting this in Cherryville, and it was a church of they had built a big new church, but they were still using the old church because they only had like 8 members left. Everybody moved away. This is in British Columbia. And but I did this sermon. They invited me to speak at this little tiny church. I mean, I don't know, it was maybe twice the big as my room in the basement, maybe even not quite that much. But yeah, there was like maybe there was 12 people there because we brought a few extra people, but there was only 8 members. Anyway, so I presented this sermon on Christ, and this one guy was just like, his just face just lit up. He just was like, man, everyone should know this, right? He said, I've never heard this preached before. But he says, this is the truth. This makes so much sense. And I was, 24 at the time. So I was pretty encouraged by it. Because I was just understanding this at that time. But it is something that just is not, it's not understood. Conservative Adventists who profess to believe Jones and Wagner, when they're presented with this, if they don't know it's Jones and Wagner, they think it's heresy. So it is something that we have to really think about.
It causes me to pause and think, where have I heard this? Because I mean, I've always kind of thought this. It wasn't like it was a new idea to me. This idea of how Jesus was and so on. I just wonder because I know when I hear it that it rings true. It sins begin to melt away in my life. But
Well, it gives us
because of
hope.
the
It gives us
understanding
hope,
of
right? It gives us so much hope when we see this.
it.
Instead of focusing upon, am I meeting up to God's standard? We start to just recognize what Christ did for us, and we start to believe, right? We start to have faith that He can actually do this because He already did it.
Right. Yeah, and I don't know, maybe I'm one of the lucky ones or whatever it is. Like I was around the kind of ideas like this almost from the time I became a Christian and Seventh-day Adventist more so. The reading the Desire of Ages, just to the Desire of Ages and seeing that Jesus did not see onto the other side of the tomb. He laid down his life. God didn't just borrow us his son. He gave us his son. He was going to be a man forever. That he took our fallen nature. This is it was it, to me. It just I heard it. I said, "Yeah, that's true." And that was like way back in the early 80s, late 70s, and then the Vendenism came in and so on. But yeah, confused me for a little while. But
Yeah, well,
yeah,
we all
this
have
is good.
different ideas floating around that have actually attacked this doctrine. And so, I mean, I believe that it's largely been attacked because of the stance in the environment of dialectical environment of argument that we've taken a position conservatives have that, well, we can overcome sin and we accept the sinful nature of Christ, but we don't fully understand what that means. Because if Jesus felt the sin, the
Wait,
condemnation, and the
wait,
curse of sin his
wait.
whole lifetime, but just let me finish. If he
I
felt
don't
that
fully
his whole
understand.
lifetime, just hang on. If he felt that his whole lifetime, then that's how he saw himself. So he didn't see himself as righteous. He saw himself as we see ourselves, but he trusted in the righteousness of his Father. Not in what he saw in his own life, right? And
Yeah.
this is what faith is about. It's not looking at ourselves and saying, have I met up to God's standard before I can believe that he's going to save me? The thing is, we expect to see ourselves as sinners in contrast to Christ's character. And And because of that, we can then overcome sin. Okay, you were going to say something there, Kelly.
You said you don't not fully understand. Well, you said this big word, dialectical argument. What's that about?
Dialectic, that's where you're arguing two sides. That is, there's
the same person.
Most people, what they do is they're arguing against another view, right? When you argue against another view, often what you do is you take positions contrary to the other person. So you're going to argue about the nature of Christ, or you're going to argue about the law in Galatians. And so if you feel that something, if you yield some truth, somebody is saying something and you yield to that, what they're saying, that you're going to lose the argument. And so you start gathering around yourselves defenses that allow you not to, or make it so that you cannot see something that you need to see, because that other person may have something that they're presenting that is true, but because they're using it for their argument, you reject it. Does that, it's a really long explanation, but does that make sense?
Yeah, no, I get it. It's the matter of pride, and there's somewhere in Spirit of Prophecy where she talks about not unable to concede a point, something like that. That's paraphrasing, but yeah. that is yeah. used, concede a point, and that really hampers a person in their growth in just discussion.
Right. So when somebody's presenting something, they may be wrong about their conclusion, but they may have some truths that they are using, especially if they're teaching error. As I've said many times, if somebody's teaching error, they're often going to dress it up with some truth. And that truth that they dress it up with is often then rejected with the, we throw out the whole kit caboodle. We throw out the baby with the bathwater, right? And so, but there might be something there. Satan often does this because there is some important point that he doesn't want us to look at. So by mixing it with error, he makes the error more attractive, but he also makes that truth less attractive. And so we get bias against it. And I used the example before of the nature of Christ, or not the nature of Christ, what happens when you die, the state of the dead, that was almost always promoted by what would be considered fanatical groups. That is, they would have attached to that doctrine other doctrines that were abhorrent to the scriptures. And so, like Jehovah's Witnesses, so people would reject the state of the dead doctrine. We talked about that with Fudge's book. He goes through the history of all these different groups that taught the truth about what happens when you die. And they tended to be fanatical groups. It was always attached to some group that had other dangerous errors. And so that would put disrepute upon this idea. Even though Lutherans technically teach what we do about the state of the dead, most Lutherans don't even know that they do.
I think it comes to me now why this idea is so natural for me to accept, and that's because when I first came into the church, before being baptized, the pastor that taught me, he was in his late 70s, early 80s. You remember Pastor Donald Watson? Well, he used to come over to the house, and you and your father would get into quite the discussions. And that was the first time I ever saw him get upset. I never used to see him get frustrated ever, but your dad was able to do that. But the reason I believe it is because I saw it. I saw it in his life and in the life of his wife, that they had indeed had a lifetime of this, and the sanctification that was in their lives was humble and sincere and without effort, it seemed to me. It was just so wonderful that I was blessed with that. He studied with me for a full year before he baptized me. Nowadays, they study for a full month, maybe. I don't know.
Well, they never even studied with me when I got 3 months, and then he said, "Well, you seem to know a lot, so you know, I'll baptize you." The other thing, though, I think is that, I mean, we also can, if we don't see ourselves as a sinner, this is not going to be very attractive to us. And I would say that there are many people who never see themselves as sinners who are Christians.
That's a rather difficult thing to think that anybody could think of themselves like that. But I guess there are, you know, people who don't have the obvious struggles with sin in their lives. The more,
they might have struggles. They just don't notice it because they.
Well, yeah. And nobody else does either, because they're not the obvious ones, like smoking and drinking and whatever.
Right. Yeah. But they gossip or whatever, you know, as the Pharisee says, you know, "God, I'm thankful I'm not like other men are, you know, fast twice in the week. I give tithes of all I possess. I'm not like this publican here." But the publican would not so much as his eyes up to heaven and say, "God, be merciful to me, a sinner." He went down to his house justified, that he's made righteous, rather than the other. And I think, you know, I mean, I can't judge other people's hearts, but I can know that when people are critical of others, that they're unforgiving, they're judgmental, they're gossips, when they misrepresent what other people believe, they misrepresent other people's characters, that they are not converted, and that they don't, and the reason they do this is because it is a way of avoiding seeing the sins in themselves. When you can see sins in others, you can sort of justify that you are better than them, that you're good enough. We don't usually intellectualize it that way, but as people would never say, "Oh, I'm perfect, right? I'm good, you know, I'm a good person," you know, if you're an Adventist, you wouldn't. But people sure act like it. Right.
Yeah.
So I mean, and I'm not here judging anyone else. I mean, all I'm saying is that we need to see ourselves as sinners. And if we don't, we are in the worst condition possible. If we can't see that we're not all right, or that we're not all wrong, that we're, you know, that there's a problem. I can't remember. I'm trying to think of how Ellen White words it. But anyway, she says it's the worst condition to be in, to think you're all right when you're all wrong. And that's us, right? We want to see ourselves as good. And that was the hindrance to me when I became a Christian. When I was converted August 11th, 1980, it was that revelation that I was indeed a sinner. That's why I came to Christ. But before that, I was just trying to be good. I was trying to be a Christian. But when I gave up, asked God to take over my life, it's because I saw that I couldn't do it. And not everybody comes to that experience. For many people, they become Adventists because they're convinced of some of the doctrines, right? And often, you know, it can be, well, you know, I'm now keeping the Sabbath and I'm better than all those Sunday keepers, right? I mean, we don't think it that way, we don't express it that way directly, but really often we're criticizing Catholics not because, you know, we actually are converted. We're just criticizing them because it builds us up, right? We look at the faults in the church and the problems with the church, and we can do it in such a way that it's just a type of pride. I'm thankful I'm not like other men are, right? That's the way that we can have that view. So, and I'm thankful that God has shown me that I'm a sinner and that he continues to do so. That in this Christian walk, we are seeking to be corrected by God. And that's trials, right? Being corrected by God is not a pleasant experience. Okay. Any final thoughts before we close with prayer? Dear Father in heaven, thank you for your goodness and love. And for the lesson tonight, I just pray that those who watch it and those that have participated this evening, that you can help us to consider these things deeply, and that we can see our true condition. We know, Lord, we struggle with sin, and we struggle to have faith and trust in you. We sometimes feel like giving up, but we know, Lord, that Christ has endured all these things for our sake, and that we can experience his sufferings and the joy that they bring. So we pray for the Sabbath that it will be truly a blessing to each person. And be with the meetings tomorrow morning. We pray and ask in Jesus' name. Amen.